Called order the January 17th meeting of the Brentwood Board of Aldermen. If you'd all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka. Alderman Weggie.
Here.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Here.
Alderman Kramer.
So glad to be here.
Mayor Thornton.
Here.
Alderwoman O'Neill.
Here.
Alderman Leahy.
Here.
Alderwoman Sims.
Here.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Here.
Thank you. Item number three on the agenda, approval of this evening's agenda. Are there any changes or additions to tonight's agenda? Seeing none, is there any objection to approval by acclamation? Seeing none, the minutes will be, or the agenda will be approved by acclamation. Item number four, we don't have any minutes from the previous meeting to consider tonight due to our city clerk's convalescence. Item number five on the agenda. Tonight we have one of our Brentwood's finest that is retiring. It is Officer Tom Zurheit. And Chief Fitzgerald is here to present an award to him. So I'll let Chief Fitzgerald take it away. Oh, well, I have the award.
I don't have an award.
Nope.
Well, we'll approach that subject when we get to
what?
The award.
Who did you give it to?
I have nothing to give.
Do you have a presentation?
Verbally.
Go ahead.
We're going to pretend we.
Okay. A few weeks ago, Sergeant Zurheit came into my office with the letter.
Ed McMahon?
No.
Oh.
Not that letter. Tom Zurheit has been with our department for almost 22 years. Before that, he was a St. Louis City officer. One of the neat things about Tom is he brought his experiences from his time in the city to Brentwood. And we have about a half a dozen officers in our department that have worked in St. Louis City. And those guys experience in for most of them, a short part of their career, more than a lot of us will ever see here in Brentwood. And that experience is invaluable. Tom had the knack for almost everything that happened here in town. He had already been through it several times in the city. And he was able to pass on that experience to all of us in a way that was always very beneficial to the guys in our department. And we're going to miss that. Tom has done a lot of different things for our department. He was in the Detective Bureau for a while. He's been a sergeant on the street for several years now, running his own shift. He's one of those guys that gets along with everybody in the department. He's a fun guy to be around, and we're going to miss his unique sense of humor. Tom also has that personality that you don't see a lot in police work, but is perfect. He's very low key. He's very calm and under control, but he has the ability to dish out the look when needed. And every once in a while, that was needed here in Brentwood. And we're going to miss Tom a lot. We're very happy he's retiring. He's earned that right to do that. Tom's here tonight with his wife, Dolores, his son, Andrew, and I'm sure they're happy to have dad and husband home a little longer, too. So it's my honor to recognize Tom for his years of service here, and we really appreciate everything you've done, Tom. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Detective Zurheit, we are going to get you a plaque. I'm sorry, there seemed to be a little bit of a confusion, but we will be getting you one. So. I, I think maybe we better throw in a dinner with that plaque, just, you know. Item number 5B on the agenda this evening, we have with us tonight is Linda Higby of Higby & Associates. If you all remember, Higby Associates are the ones who did our compensation study in 2014. Pursuant to the ordinance we passed in November of last year, we review our compensation data every 2 years for consistency with the market as per the per our market-based compensation scheme. And so Higby Associates has undertaken to update our compensation data and make recommendations on how we need to change that data since it's been 2 years since the original study was completed. So without further ado, I will introduce Linda Higby of Higby Associates. I would also tell the board, we are not voting on anything tonight. This is the equivalent of the first reading without it actually being a first reading. You're free to ask Ms. Higby questions. I don't think she minds if you actually ask during the presentation. This is for the information of the board. And then based on sort of the discussion that takes place and some of the questions, we'll have an ordinance, an appropriate ordinance will become forthcoming at the next meeting or the one after to pass and adopt. So is everybody clear on that? It's just a presentation for information, chance to ask questions.
Okay, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. I see a couple of familiar faces, but as anticipated, there are a few of you I have not met before. So you weren't here during the original study. And I'll apologize, I'll run through this as quickly or as slowly as you want, but I thought it might be helpful, at least on a high level, to bring everybody back to kind of where we started from and then go into the update for this year. So to the extent that I bore you or I see you going to sleep, we'll speed right through it. And otherwise, if you have questions as we pick it up, we'll be happy to do that as well. For those of you who weren't here, we have a process we follow when we do a study. And one of them is that we completed job descriptions. So we actually interviewed employees. We talk to them about what they do, what kind of experiences they have to have in order to do their job, those kinds of things. So we had a really good feel for what your employees do. We then surveyed all of your comparators. We looked at pay ranges. We also looked at average rates of pay, and you're going to hear a little bit about that tonight and why that's important. We matched jobs based on content, skill, and scope. So when we went out to the comparators, when they were matching jobs, when we were matching jobs, we were looking at the content of the job, we were looking at your requirements for the job, what kind of education, any of those kind of factors in order to match jobs. You ultimately decided to set your ranges at the 75th percentile of that market, of those 13 comparator cities that you picked. And so that's a piece of what we're going to talk about tonight as well. If you have questions, usually I'm pretty good at catching folks, but I've also got a gentleman in the back that's trying to make sure I talk into this mic so he can get everything, so just holler at me. Okay, when we look at who's a comparator or comparator city, we look at a wide variety of things. We did this with you when we did your study. One of the things we talked to was all of your department heads. Who do you lose people to? Who do you try to recruit from if you're actually out looking for somebody in the market? So we looked at all of these factors for you, including producing a report for you that said, here's kind of how you compare on a number of these factors to the 13 cities that you picked. So those are the kind of things we looked at to come up with this group of cities. And these were the cities that you approved as your comparators a couple of years ago when we did your original study. Those are exactly the same cities that we went out to when we updated your system for this year. Okay. When we did your original study, 90% of the jobs, remember we went out and we talked to your employees, we knew what the content of the job was, 90% of your jobs we had matches for. Content, skill, and scope, solid matches. Six, we had less than three matches for, meaning you had that job, but four or more of those cities didn't have the job. So we had a few we didn't. Three of those six were in sanitation. As most of you in this room know, there's only a couple of players in that market right now that still have internal sanitation folks. 25% of your, or 25 classifications or 58% of your employees were above comparator average range maximums, meaning that you were already far into the market when we did that study. 14 were below market, 14 classifications. A number of those were on the maintenance area that we've talked about before. And 11 were sort of right solid in the market. You had pegged market and you were right on top of it when we did that study. Questions on this? I'm going to show you graphically kind of how that translates. Okay, this is how you compare. We had four jobs where there was no match. A couple of those we lost during the process because you decided not to refill those positions. So we had six initially. you were down to four just because you didn't refill those positions. 15 of those had the highest pay in the marketplace. So again, one of the things you're looking at here sort of shows you that you had a few jobs on that back end where when we were looking at them, you still had some work to do to come up to market, even market average, not even the 75th. But you had a lot of other jobs where you were leading the market. Okay. So how does it compare by job classification? So again, you've got 46 classifications, meaning 46 distinct jobs, 15 lead, 21 match, 6 lag, and 4 we had no comparables for. So we were looking at them internally in terms of how you valued them.
Linda, that 21 match number, when I looked at that chart, it looked like the second and third highest were included in the match.
Correct.
Okay. So correct. Even if we were second or third in the market, you considered that a match.
Yes. You're within range. When we consider somebody to lead, that means you're outpacing everybody else.
Okay. So lead is actually number one out of all.
Lead is really leading, yeah, when we look at that. Okay. You have 106 full-time employees, roughly, or did at the time of the study. 42 employees were in ranges that were leading the market. 33 were matching the market, meaning that they were right in step with it. 25, you still had some catch up that you needed to do. And then 6, obviously, we couldn't make that comparison because we didn't have matches for. So again, whether you're looking at your employees or whether you're looking just at classifications, by and large, you were in a really good position to make the decision you ultimately make to say, hey, we were going to be at the 75th percentile. As many of you are aware, because you are familiar with other municipalities, most folks are looking at meeting the market, not leading the market or being at the 75th. So you know where that is coming in. So again, just visually, this is kind of where your employees sit. 40% are in ranges. Now, these are ranges. And one of the pieces that we like to distinguish, and you're going to hear a little bit about that tonight, you have folks that we can tell you that not only does their range lead the market, but you're paying above range for those jobs. And because you're not just leading the range, but you're paying way above that even for some of those classifications. And so that's kind of key for you to keep in the back of your mind as you make your decisions on a go-forward basis. So this just tells you kind of where your employees shake out of those 106. Questions for me? Again, I know I have new faces, and I know we did a report, so you probably just, you know, had a couple of insomniac nights reading through all that. But if not, I'm happy to answer questions. Excuse me, we also looked at your employee benefits when we were here, and this is truly a simplification compared to the lots of pages we did on benefits for you. But pretty much what you find is that you were kind of right in the money with market on most of these. You had a couple of paces, a short-term disability on a particular area. A lot of your comparators have a sick leave loan bank kind of thing that you don't have, but overall your benefits were sort of right in the sweet spot. So since the original study, one of the things we like to look at is what have you done since we did this work? You know, how quickly did you implement? What have you really been able to accomplish from that implementation date forward? One of the things that we asked you to do was to really think through a compensation philosophy statement. Because in the absence of that, yes, we ultimately said you're going to be at the 75th, but now you've got to decide how are you going to spend those resources. And right now, it's my understanding Brentwood's in really good shape, but eventually people do have sort of a squeeze on dollars. You have some capital projects, whatever. So you have to have some guiding principles, if you will, about how you're going to spend your money. And from a pay perspective, if you know what your core values are, it helps guide you. It limits your liability, the folks sitting in this room, so that you don't get mired down in individual pay or individual pay classifications, if you will, and it also helps you look at your strategic goals and say, how are you going to do this? How do we manage pay within all of that? And helps you build a long-term consistent framework around pay. So your employees understand what you pay against, you understand it. When it comes time to update your ranges, when it comes time to look at, are we going to give raises and what do they look like this year? You've got a guiding framework to go by. And it's my understanding.
The other thing I'd point out there, Linda, is I think particularly in this environment where the constituency of the board changes over time, you know, it helps in that sense of when the board turns over, the philosophy doesn't.
Continuity. Correct.
Continuity between political entity.
Okay. Okay, so we made some recommendations when we were here before. We like making recommendations. We like it even more when we come back 2 years later and we're seeing some of those in action. At the top of our list is you really need a compensation philosophy. You need something that's going to guide you on how you're going to pay. We asked that our recommendation was that you discontinue longevity increases. We could find no basis in the marketplace of your comparators to continue what you were doing there. We also suggested that you stop giving base building increases to people who are above range maximum. When we did your study, you had a range maximum, and if somebody hit that maximum, you just kept giving them their 3% every year without a top to it. So they just kept getting raises. We also gave you what we consider to be an appropriate priority list for spending your money, because most municipalities cannot do everything. And so we try to help you sort of manage what should your priority list or checklist look like. The first is you got to take care of those folks who are below minimum. For the people that you aren't even barely getting to market, you need to take care of those folks first. Second is you got to get people on that step plan that you selected and keep them moving forward, the step increases. And then if you've got some money left, you give what we call non-base building merits, meaning that if you have people who are sitting at the top of their range and they've had phenomenal performance that year, you may hand them a non-base building amount of money. Again, that generated a lot of discussion at the time we went through it. And the key for me is it's your third priority. It's at the bottom of the pay list in terms of things you need to do. Now, if everybody's everywhere and you still have money left over, absolutely consider it, especially if you're doing performance management and people are performing well. And on the benefits, we had a couple of suggestions for you. Monitoring that sick leave contribution for health and dental, you were kind of on the bubble in terms of what you're asking your employees to pay. And so we asked you to kind of monitor it, not change it at this point, but just keep an eye on it so that you are competitive with that comparator group. And then also to consider alternatives for the sick plan for fire, because when we looked at it, even on a fire basis, it required some modification to be competitive. Questions for me? Okay.
So far, so good.
Wow, we got through that review really fast. Okay, it's my understanding, and I think Chris is going to jump in here and help as well, that since we did that study, you did a lot of work, and I know I participated in a couple of meetings where we talked about what does that look like and what does it feel like. You have done a lot of work around your compensation philosophy. Do you want to speak to this? Do you want me to go through?
Well, I won't come as any surprise to anybody in this room because they've heard it over and over and over again from me. So, you know, the key points being the sustainability and the rationality, right? The rationality being that it be something that's based on objective measures, right? Data. And that helps us take, you know, our feelings out of things and just look at the data and what it tells us and helps us guide our decisions. The second part being sustainability, which I think is equally important, right? Not only sustainable from the city's budget perspective, but also from the commitment to the employee perspective, right? We're not over-promising something that we can't deliver down the road, right? So that an employee who invests a 30-year career with us knows that we're going to be in a good financial position to continue to make good on our promises, as opposed to, you know, going up and down and up and down, you know, declaring bankruptcy and some of these other things that you see other cities do. So that's it.
So those were the two pieces. Again, from my perspective, you've delivered on the first thing we asked you to do, which is to work on your compensation philosophy. And one of the things that we spent some time on last time when I was here, and I think it's a good reminder today, when we talk about what is the 75th percentile, you have 13 comparators, and I think the definition that you guys have looked at is spot on, and it's the very simplest, easiest way. You don't get into a lot of mathematical calculations. It's really simple. You have 13 comparators, so we are looking for three comparator cities that might be higher than you, but 10 are going to be lower. That's what you're looking at. That's the 75th percentile for the group that you have. Questions? Okay. I must be doing a really good job. I am not getting any questions.
Either okay. That or the mayor's bored him to death with this stuff before.
Okay, so you're telling me I'm redundant. I did it. No. All right. So here's how your update process works. We selected 16 benchmark positions. 12 of those were in what we call, or 14 of those were in CORE, meaning that 12-step plan. We looked at those, and we looked at two public safety positions. When we looked at those 16 positions, they cover almost 70% of your employee base, actually just under 70%. So that's why you only have to look at a few of them once you get your market plan rolling. One of the things that we did, obviously, was we excluded those that we couldn't match before because they probably aren't there this time. And we didn't want you to spend your time and energy there. We surveyed those same comparators. Once again, had a phenomenal response rate. They were very responsive. We got data back very quickly. We excluded your internal equity roles when we calculated how do you need to adjust your ranges, meaning that if you made an internal equity adjustment last time from market, we pulled those out when we were looking at what kind of range adjustment you need. So here's what we mean by that.
I saw a couple people.
You frowned at me, Andy.
You had those employees that were lagging. And what you're
Correct.
Talking about is what the city did to adjust for them to try to still bring them up. And thus you're not re-looking at those same positions this time.
For example, we made it, the data last time suggested that there was a slight difference between firefighter, paramedic, and police officer. But we made an internal equity decision to put firefighters, paramedic, and police officer on the same level because traditionally Brentwood had always done that. So that was an internal equity decision. One of the ones that I remember quite clearly was we made that decision to go from here to here with the police officer position because we always had. And it was a small jump. It was only a difference of a little bit.
Okay.
So that's what she's talking about, is she pulled that out of the data.
Okay, because the key there is we did do police officer, for example, because that's a huge chunk of your employee population of that 106 folks. So we did include them, but when we looked at how do you need to adjust ranges, we pulled those out because you weren't keeping them at market level last time. Okay, so that's what we mean by that. Okay, when we looked at all of that, when you look at your 12-step classification, so that's your non-public safety roles, when you look at that over the time we did the study before to just completing it again this past fall, 1.4% adjustment in range. So again, what you're seeing is that your comparator group is making a little bit of movement in range maximums, but not a lot. Okay, so people are moving through those ranges. We suggested some grade changes for those where there was more than a 5% variance from market, high or low. So for example, when we were here before, you were doing some restructuring in your maintenance area, and we came in and said, this is kind of what market looks like, and you're going, that doesn't fit us right now. So we came back, we looked at those same jobs this year, and because some of those were more than 5%, we pulled those out of that 1.4% again, and we are suggesting to you that you make some grade adjustments for those roles because you're through that restructuring at this point. Okay, and that internal equity place role, the easy ones.
The other thing that came into play there, just to remind everybody, was that in some cases we were so far below the median even for the range that to make all of that adjustment in one leap would have been kind of ridiculous. So we really did make the very conscious decision to move kind of halfway in one and then look at it again in another year for the next.
Yeah, you made a very conscious decision that you would achieve market levels, and your market is now defined as the 75th, so that you would first adjust to average and then you would adjust up from there for those particular roles. Okay, for your 7-step folks, this is your public safety. Again, we looked at firefighter, paramedic. We also looked at police officer. Those are the two we're going to talk about tonight. On the firefighter, paramedic, the minimum made a big jump over the last time we looked at this, so we wanted to make sure you're aware of that. You have a 5.75 step in order to keep your 7 steps for this group, and again, there was a ton of discussion when we did this initially over that. So one of the things we found is that you don't need to adjust that range maximum. It's just fine. It's still kind of hanging out there in front. So you didn't need to adjust the range max, but you do need to make an adjustment to the minimum, and that's our recommendation too. You're going to see that here in a minute, is that you keep your 7 steps, you adjust the first step, but you don't have to adjust steps 2 through 7. Okay, police officer. This is the one we spoke about earlier that was an internal equity slotting last time. We wanted to look at that again because it's such a huge number of your employee population. Adjustments not required to minimum or the maximum to retain your position. Minimums and maximums exceed the 75th of your comparator group, and the average pay exceeds all of your comparators. And that's from the 2014 study. Yeah, when we're looking at all that, it's all there. Nothing's really changed from 2014. What's happened in some cases, we're going to talk a little bit about this later, is that the gap between police officer and firefighter paramedic, the entry points, are growing as opposed to, they were pretty small before, so it was a pretty easy internal equity decision. We want you to make another thoughtful decision this year if you want to keep them there. Questions? Okay. Here are my recommendations. We are suggesting that you adjust that 12-step classification by 1.4%. We've run those numbers for you in terms of what those ranges would look like. We recommend adjusting the minimum for firefighter paramedic to market level and keeping steps 2 through 7 the same. So again, no adjustments on the top end because you're still leading, but you need to bring your minimum up to be competitive at the level you want to be. The police officer and detective range, you can create a competitive market range, and if you're committed to market-based pay, that would be your pure solution, if you will, is to create that range, and right now that 75th is 54.6 to 76.4. So again, it's lower than where you currently have it positioned because you made a very conscious decision last time to pull it up. Your current range is 56.1 to 78.5. You certainly could leave it there and not adjust it to be in parity with fire, so that's another option. And then your internal equity move, obviously, is that you would have to adjust that to match fire if that's still where you wanted it to be.
Linda, just to be clear, so right now, police and firefighter are at the same...
You have them exactly the same.
Level 17 on the, or whatever it
level
is.
Level 17, and they are all currently 56.1 to 78.5 in a seven-step kind of piece. So that's where we came in terms of your update this year. Questions for me? I'm just doing a phenomenal job. There are no questions for me. Come on, talk to me. Yes.
Could you just go through that 17P again for me?
Sure.
What's the rationale? So 17P right now is in 17?
Right now, you have only grade 17. That is where you
Correct.
Are currently. And that's the 56.1 to 78.5. What we're saying is that should you choose to go to pure market, you would adjust that range from that to 54.6 to 76.4. That's not taking money away from anybody who's already at 78.5 or in some cases above that. But if you're committed to market, we created something called a 17P, saying that's what pure market looks like for that particular role.
Okay.
You certainly have a variety of options around that. You could keep the current range. You could freeze it, if you will, and see what happens when you update next time. You know, the other option is you could certainly keep moving it up with the firefighter paramedic. But ultimately, if you start hiring, that's a pretty expensive decision because even though we aren't adjusting steps 2 through 7, the difference between 54 and 58, if you ever get in a hiring position, or I don't know how many new guys you hire each year, that can be a pretty significant difference.
Brandon? So this is a question for Linda, really, but maybe for Bola. So if we do implement the 17P, and I know we've talked about this, but what happens to somebody who's already in a certain step? And if you're changing those ranges, would they be reclassified into a new step if necessary?
So if you're currently in 17, and Linda, you might be able to help me, and you're at higher step, ordinarily, if we leave it the way it is, you'd be going to 59. But if we go to 17P, you'd be going to 57. And that would be less than the 5.75%, right, differential.
It would result in... For people who are currently in the matrix, not capped, mm-hmm. It would result in one short step for them. If we do nothing at this point and those positions continue to diverge, at some point we would be forced, I presumably forced, mm-hmm. to make that decision. There would be a shorter step. The longer you wait and the bigger that gap, the shorter that step gets, right? So. Mm-hmm.
A good way to think about the gap is that when we did your original study, my recollection is that it was just under $2,000 difference between the higher point for a police officer at the 75th and a firefighter paramedic. What you've seen happen over the course of the time, almost 2 years or so since we've done that study, is you've seen that grow to almost $4,000 for an entry point.
So a question for the board to think about is if there's an employee that's going from 56 and then the board adopts the 17P, it's less than that, what I said earlier, it's less than that 5.75% step, whereas everybody else is potentially getting either the 575 or...
There's a couple different ways we could handle that, too. First thing is, I think we've all agreed from the outset that none of these decisions would ever result in anybody losing Penn.
Right.
The second is that I think if the board were so inclined to adjust for that one-time shift, that you could, you know, consider everybody in that range getting two steps that
right.
time. So
mm-hmm.
instead of
right.
resulting in a small decrease to what they might get, it might work to their advantage.
Correct. Right. Anybody who's in the matrix.
Right, right. Yeah. To make, I mean, you know, to be fair for the adjustment, it's a one-time thing. It's
right.
not like, and it's
yeah.
not their fault. I mean, it's just the market.
Exactly. Well, from a consistency standpoint, when you did your implementation before, the way it was done is once you decided that you were going to do those seven steps, what we looked at is where people currently were, and when they were due their next raise, they went to the next step. So if you indeed decided to go to 17P, you might want to revisit and keep that same methodology. So it's not you're skipping two steps, it's simply we're doing the same methodology we did before. The range changed, you're at 56, but instead of going to 50 whatever, you're going to whatever that next step is.
And I will say that all of that was conditioned on satisfactory performance review.
Correct.
For people
correct.
Who were sub-performers, none of that.
That's correct.
Right.
But I'm assuming for the sake of this discussion yes. that we're talking about somebody who's satisfactory.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Other questions for me?
Is there any further discussion at this time from the board? Like I said, the whole idea here is, I guess we're going to bring forward an appropriate, well, what we'll do is we'll run it through the Ways and Means Committee. And we'll bring forward, we'll let the Ways and Means Committee decide which ordinance to bring to the board, and then we'll go from there. How about that?
Could I applaud sure. your staff? I mean, one of the things that we suggested and Bola's staff did was to take a look at what were the cost implications right now of the recommendations that we're making. So when your Ways and Means is ready to meet, that information is already available for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, and I think the board has it in front of them this evening. So
good
yeah.
job. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and thank you to Bola and Karen for getting all this together and for Linda for making this happen tonight. We really appreciate it. I know it was difficult to bring it all together in such a short time, but appreciate it.
Good job.
Any other? I told people you were lively and asked questions.
You
I just
were
did
prepared.
Such an awesome job.
I told people they'd be out of here in an hour tonight, so.
Mayor Thornton, I should mention that Linda flew in from Dallas, which is where she's currently located. So if there's need for additional questions
yeah,
and ways
yeah,
and means.
That's a good point, Bola. There is no plan to have Ms. Higby back, so. The whole.
I was going to say,
wow.
wait a minute.
No offense.
You did a presentation, no questions.
Let me rephrase.
Good, come back.
Okay. When the actual ordinance comes before the board, the idea is that you have a chance to ask questions now. So take advantage before she leaves, and otherwise we'll wish her bon voyage.
Can I give a. I just want to say this is one of the most succinct, to the point, brief presentations that I've sat through. I could follow it. You had your figures. It all made sense. Thank you so much.
Safe travels, Linda. All right. Item number 6 on the agenda. We have no public hearing this evening. We have no bids for number 7. So we get to item number 8, which is a hearing of any matter of public interest upon the request of any person present. We're going to do it slightly differently tonight because we have another guest with us. First of all, I'm going to ask if anyone on the board has any objection to me extending the 3-minute time limit to address the board to Mr. Hassenflew, who has joined us this evening to talk a little bit about financing for his project. So is there any objection on the board to me extending the 3-minute time limit? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead and invite Mr. Hassenflew up, and then the rest of the public will be offered the opportunity to come up. But Mr. Hassenflew came all the way from Kansas City, so we're going to listen to him first.
All right. Thank you, Mayor, Alderman. Gary Hassenflew, 2020 Broadway, Kansas City, Missouri. I'm here before you to make a request for a tax abatement for the Metro Manchester project at northwest corner of Manchester and Hanley. This body, of course, approved this project, it's been probably 3-4 months now. And since then, we've been working on finalizing our financing, and we have a situation where we have a gap We also have a competitive situation with other developments of like nature, and they are getting tax abatement in their various jurisdictions. And what we're asking for is nothing more than anybody else has been asking in these neighboring jurisdictions and are getting, which is a 70% abatement for a 10-year period. Now, the nice kicker we're willing to throw in with this is that we would donate the land for a pedestrian bridge that would cross the creek to the east to the Metrolink stop. And so it would be a benefit not only, of course, for our residents, but also for the whole community that struggles right now with the condition of that bridge and getting over there. And, you know, we all, I hope, agree that, you know, public transit is a great thing. The more that can be used, the better for our environment, for dollars saved, to you name it. And we certainly want to be part of that encouragement of that process. What still has to be determined is the cost of the bridge and how that'll be paid for, that actual bridge. But in talking to staff, there's some ideas there that they've had. And so tonight, we're just here to ask for their ability to negotiate with staff to enter into the redevelopment agreement as described, so we can move forward on this. And this also will be an indication to my lender of the municipality's willingness to do that, which would be highly encouraging to them, as we hope to close by in the next 2 weeks on our initial funding to take down the land, finish construction drawings, start construction another four months. Any questions?
Thank you. Well, let me just first say, so this evening, folks, the goal is to give you the opportunity to ask Mr. Hassifield any questions that you might have. Also to pass some sort of direction for staff to proceed with a formalized agreement, a redevelopment agreement that would encapsulate some of these basic terms, but to give everybody the opportunity to kind of state what they'd like to see in terms of those basic terms and what they'd like that redevelopment agreement to contain. There would certainly, a vote to move forward in that direction is not a vote to extend the tax abatement or anything of the kind. It's simply a vote to direct staff to use the necessary resources to get the agreement in place to bring it back, and then that would be the effective agreement. So what this would do for Mr. Hassenflew is give his investors a sense of whether this board is serious about offering some sort of redevelopment incentive or not. And that's really kind of what we're looking at. So, with that, any questions for Mr. Hassenflew? Alderman Wagon.
Just a simple one. So, Mr. Hassenflew, so do you think the pedestrian bridge, do you believe that adds value to your development, or do you view that as a kind of a burden that's being put on you?
If we have to participate in the cost, it would certainly be a burden.
But I mean, just the existence of
we,
it.
There'd be a ancillary benefit to some level in that there'd be maybe less parking used. But we have plenty of parking where we are right now. So it's really more of a community project, in my opinion, for what we do for the community.
Do you think there would be a benefit to the future residents, a metro, that they would be able to get to the Metrolink station easier than having to go along the small Manchester Bridge?
Yeah, there should be some benefit of that. Where I really see benefit is if there's any handicap individuals, if we can have handicapped accessibility with whatever this new pedestrian bridge will be, then that'd be great. I think we all agree for the disadvantaged, but B, for those that part of the population, which will be small, but may live in my development.
Mm-hmm. I think I would also argue for the not so nimble. I mean, the older I get,
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Alderman Lockman.
I guess, Mr. Hassifield, you can kind of lay this at my foot for suggesting this pedestrian crossing right there, because if, as you've mentioned, if you looked at that road, that bridge across Black Creek, it's not ADA accessible. And I just thought maybe your project, being Metro on Manchester, would want some linkage to the Metrolink station. And if, as you see from what you're going to develop, point A, where the Metrolink is, there's not really a consistent pedestrian pathway between the two.
Yeah.
And I just thought that this would be a way to benefit the people of the development once you have it built, and also the people, the citizens of Brentwood, having this convenient way to get from point A to point B.
Yeah, I think there's benefits for both. Thank you.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hassenfluh, this blighted study that was performed by PGAV, can you tell us who hired PGAV?
We hired PGAV.
Okay. And what were the circumstances behind you hiring them? Why did you do it?
We hired them in order to see if we could demonstrate that there was blight on this property for the purpose of tax abatement.
And you retained them, the study is dated October 31st of 2016. Mm-hmm. When, do you know when it was that you retained PGAV to perform this blight study?
Oh, I believe it probably would have been September 2016.
Excuse me. So prior to September 16th, you didn't have any concern about that being a blighted area?
No, I always had concern about it being blighted, but I needed to first go through the rezoning process here before taking this to
so law. It was only after the Board of Aldermen approved the conditional use permit and the rezoning then that you went ahead and retained PGAV?
Yes, sir. Okay. One step at a time. Yes, sir.
There are some financials that are attached to this report, identified tables 1 through 7. Did PGAV draft those or complete those tables, or do you know?
Yeah,
who did
PGAV
that?
Completed those tables and with some assistance from me and filling in, providing the numbers,
okay,
cost numbers and the like.
Well, Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I don't know if it's okay to get down. I have just a few questions about this study. Is this a good time to ask these questions, or should that be done later?
Well, there's no objection from anyone else on the board. Go ahead.
Continue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The page.
Mr. Hassenfluh, I don't know if you have it in front of you.
I don't have a.
You mind taking Alderman Leahy's there?
PGAV representative here either, but I'll do my best.
Take a shot.
All right.
On page 6, there's reference to table 1, area parcel data, metro on Manchester, city of Brentwood for 2016, and it lists the two lots that are the subject of the rezoning conditional use permit. Correct?
Correct.
And it has assessed value for those two lots, improvements being zero, because there's nothing on there currently, right?
Yeah, for the improvements, there's just land value.
Right, right. And the land, it's totaled for the assessed value, $834,420.
Correct.
And that's as of 2016? That's what your table says, or the report?
Don't have any reason to doubt that, no.
Okay. Now, if you would turn to the back of the report, mm-hmm, and table 3.
Before all the appendices?
Yeah, table 3 in the of the appendix.
It's a separate document.
I'm sorry?
It's a separate document.
That you're in this document.
Oh, okay.
Document.
Can, yeah. You grab that one there?
Yeah. He's jumping you. They gave us supportive data. Yes.
Table 3.
It's the most recent equalized assessed valuation, EAV, and taxpayer data.
Right.
Tell me if you're there.
I'm here.
Okay. It references the same two lots, and I've just my question here is, here it says over at the far right column, 2016 total assessed value is $335,840. You compare that back to table 1 on page 6, where it said the total assessed value was $834,420,000. I'm just wondering, can you explain the $500,000 difference in the assessed value?
I absolutely cannot.
Okay.
Obviously, there's some clerical error here. If I certainly had to believe one, it'd be the $834,000 in assessed value,
okay,
total.
And again, this is a report that PGAV offered.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And perhaps, you know,
I'm,
we
I'm
could
gonna
have
a venture moment. A guess that you've seen somebody transpose assessed value and appraised value in that table.
And that's what I'm wondering if it was, but I'm still a little confused with them because of
right, no,
the prior table.
Yeah. Right. Because the appraised value doesn't match up with the assessed value either.
Right, because the appraised value on table one, no, I'm sorry.
Does not match up with the appraised value on table three.
Yeah, it's and all I'm getting to
200,000 is
$200,000 off. Yeah, there's some confusion right. on these.
There is, and I will certainly, you know, get clarification and correction to this to
okay.
make it right.
Mr. Chairman, that's all the questions I had about that report.
Thank you. Alderman Kramer.
Yes, Your Honor. Hello there, Mr. Hassenflew.
Hello.
let's see, Mr. Mayor, if I could ask, we've got these resolutions this evening. Are they, is there an emergent need? Are we doing those one of those tonight?
Yes.
Well, okay. I guess what I would say to that is there isn't a need to pass either one of those resolutions necessarily,
okay.
but we do need to direct staff as to whether we want them to pursue a development agreement with Mr. Hassenflew or whether we want them to not pursue a development agreement with Mr. Hassenflew, which would involve hiring somebody to evaluate this report, getting a legal team on board to draft the agreement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a significant amount of effort and expense involved, and we do need to direct staff to either do it or not do it.
Okay.
Also, if I may add, I spoke to Mark Grimm, the city's bond counsel, and he said in his opinion, since the Mr. Hassenflew already retained PGAV, that the city could choose to use the blight study that we have already that has been paid for instead of going out and having him pay for another blight study. The only other firm that we would consider other than PGAV would be Development Strategies. There are two firms in town that most municipalities use, and it's one of the two of those. He also said that the tax impact statement has already been completed as well by PGAV, so that is part of the blight study that they did. So the city could also use this document as well instead of paying another firm to do that.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Interesting.
Like I said, it doesn't have to be specifically these, but we do need to give them some sort of direction.
Okay.
I would like to interject and make it clear that PGAV is all about objectivity. They didn't put in these numbers what I told them to put in. They put the inputs in, but in terms of the tax impact analysis and the like, and that is all their computations that they use and all the municipalities in the area. And they showed me the numbers. I said, okay, let's get it to the city. And that was that. There was no messing around from there. I want to assure you all that. Yes.
If I could continue.
Go ahead. Sure.
Mr. Hassenflew, when you were here last and we approved the permits and the development, there was some conversation that evening about this topic, whether or not you may need some assistance. So I'm asking, since that approval, your cost basis, things have been reevaluated to the point where you decided that you needed this assistance, or is the assistance being asked for because everybody else is getting it?
We needed both. I mean, we have to enable to obtain the kind of rents we're asking for. We're going to need this assistance because our expenses are at Y, our rents are at X, and then our costs are at Z. And yes, our costs are higher. Part of the reason why the costs are higher is because, and this was discussed at the meeting, and why we also even at that time had mentioned there is a case for blight here, and that is that this corner was totally underutilized because nothing was on it. It was useless to the city. Most of it's, a third of it's in the floodplain. So now we're stuck with a very small footprint. We can't spread our high cost items like parking onto surface lots there. We have to build a garage. And not only do I have to build a garage, we got to build a two-story garage. And, the garage alone is a $2.5 million item. So, we're in a difficult situation here in that we have to find the money to pay for this. We have to find a way to have a project that can support itself. And if we're gonna do that, we're gonna have to get this type of assistance.
So some of the analysis of your, the structural needs, for example, the parking floodplain issues that go along with that. I guess the question that the residents would want to ask, I have marked last, but I'll ask it now if I can. But for this assistance, would you go ahead and build the development anyway?
No.
Okay. The last time that the city of Brentwood went through this process was with the city's, the Villas at Brentwood, which is an apartment complex down the street. You may have, you know, Frederick Gauthier, very interesting gentleman, who came to us with that development. And we had an opportunity to go through the process with him and the negotiation of the quality of the materials, the site coverage, landscaping. One of the additional items that he had, that he brought to the table, the needs were, that was a situation with existing property owners, some of which did not want to leave. And there was a need for compensation. And we assisted with that through the tax abatement process. The benefits, which have been discussed to a certain extent by way of social media, allow for an area such as this that otherwise may not have been developed for some time or may not have received any enhancement of tax receipts to the city for some time. This tool allows for that number to stay the same perceivably for a while or close to the same based on the percentages that are requested. And then after that period of time goes away, the number goes up. City benefits, the developer is allowed to offset some costs. The school district does well as well. And in that case, do we know, Bola, has the school district been consulted on this topic?
Actually, the Board of Education has not as a group been formally consulted. However, I did ring up Chairman Ravenberg and talk to him about it and asked him if he had a sense of how the Board of Education felt about it. And his response to me was that in general, the Board of Education felt that these deals in the past had been particularly good for the school district and that they felt, you know, obviously they'd want to see particulars, et cetera, but in general, they were supportive of these types of deals, and particularly in the case of a residential development, he felt that they would be very supportive.
And let me make it clear, this is just a 70% abatement of increased taxes.
Right.
Yes.
Base we're paying, just like,
right. Yes,
like
yes,
you're
yes.
receiving
yes.
now.
Right.
Yeah.
So in that vein, just to refresh back to the Villas at Brentwood, that was a more sizable request. They had more sizable needs, and we had an opportunity to negotiate with them on some different varying factors. In this case, it's kind of reversed. Planning and zoning has already gone through the process with you. You've discussed and negotiated certain things that you're willing to do. One of those, I believe, which is not expensive, is the color scheme on the
yes, that was discussed at length.
Go
University of Illinois.
Yes. We appreciate you coming to us with your proposal, and I guess, Mr. Mayor, I would highlight that, as some have discussed outside this meeting, the benefits of this project being completed, the benefits of Mr. Hassenflew willing, in this case, to work with the city towards Alderman
Lockmiller's
proposal. Sorry.
You've been gone a while.
I've been...
Call it the Lockmiller Bridge.
And no. Bogota, things happen to your mind. Anyway, the fact of the matter is that you're willing to work with the city. This will allow the city to have a benefit and amenity for the residents. That particular entrance to our city has been sitting like that for quite some time. I appreciate your answers to the questions. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mayor Thornton, may I interject to Alderman Kramer's comment about notification of the taxing district? That would be part of negotiating or putting together the redevelopment agreement. So there is still a process to do that in all taxing districts.
Got it. Thank you.
The other thing that I wanted to point out, and I think Tom made clear, but I want to make sure everybody in the audience is clear on this. So what Mr. Hassenflew has requested is a 70% abatement. So he's requesting that going forward, that 70% of the taxes related to that site be abated for a period of 10 years. The way the numbers work in this particular case is that, the tax revenue to the city and all other taxing districts from that property is just the property alone. And if you look at what's been requested, what would result is the amount of money that we're getting from pieces of empty property, the taxes paid on those pieces of empty property, would be approximately equal to the amount of money we would continue to receive for the next 10 years with the abatement in place.
Right.
So Mr. Hassenflew would essentially be keeping the amount of increased taxes that he's bringing into existence by virtue of developing that site for a period of 10 years, after which they would go back to the city and the school district, et cetera. So, you know, some people may be under the impression that this is the city giving money to Mr. Hassenflew or something like that. It's not the case at all. But for the development, there wouldn't be higher taxes. Without those higher taxes, there wouldn't be a tax abatement to give. So that's kind of what's going on here, folks. And I just want to make sure everybody's clear on that. Alderman Leahy.
Thank you, sir. Gary, let me ask, because I'm going to keep it in layman's terms. Has your group closed on buying the property in question? So you're still negotiating with your contract to get the purchase?
Well, we've negotiated under purchase. Well, we've negotiated the contract, and so all the terms
you
are
have
settled.
A contingency clause that
right
in it. All right, you're taking an area based on your resolutions that we're looking at. You're going to take an area of land that MSD and the Corps of Engineers says you can't build on. And you're going to donate that land to the point that the city might go get a grant to get the Transportation Department of the state of Missouri to help build a bridge over the creek to get us from your properties over to Manchester Road.
Well, from all properties, especially on the north side of Manchester Road, yeah.
Okay, so in working this through, you're allowing then, or you're going to be looking in the redevelopment agreement for the public to have public access through your property to use this bridge.
Absolutely.
To work it through. And in exchange for this, you're looking for about $445,000 of tax abatement over a 10-year period of time.
That's correct.
Your group is not offering to contribute or build the bridge. That's hopefully if we get a state grant or something to make the bridge a feasible project. Am I understanding things correctly?
Those are the resolutions that are on the table.
Okay.
I think there, if the board gives staff direction to move forward with this plan, I would think that staff would have the flexibility to look at additional options, which would be to slightly increase the abatement to allow Mr. Hassenflew to, you know, but we just don't have the numbers on what it would take
okay.
to get it done.
Now,
so it could be the rest of the increment, the 100% minus the 70%. Could go get applied to that. You could also, by state statute, increase the period of the abatement in order to help pay for the road. So those are other potential sources.
There are a number
or
of options.
Get a grant.
Or you could get a city grant.
The dilemma I have is you're looking at a potential bridge building using land adjacent to the creek so that we can go east to west in an area that two of the industries, MSD and the Corps of Engineers, have already told us we can't build on.
No.
Or otherwise
no,
you would have
no.
expended
they,
your project.
They've had
to
discussions.
You can't build a parking lot.
Well, if I can't build a parking lot, how am I going to put a bridge in this place?
No, I spoke to MoDOT, Missouri Department of Transportation, and they indicated to me that there are other communities. They gave me an example, Wildwood, for instance. They seem to be one municipality that's been putting in a lot of these pedestrian bridges, and they haven't gone for grant. They've paid it out of city coffers, so that's clearly an option. And we can, to confirm it, we can definitely talk to MSD to assure you all that they don't have disagreement with the direction that the city's going. But in talking to MoDOT, they seem to indicate that this is not new. It's done elsewhere.
Okay, but MoDOT is saying one thing. MSD and the Corps of Engineers.
I don't know what MSD is saying because I haven't asked them that.
They redeveloped this whole project and made it change, saying that portions of these two properties was not going to be allowed to be built on.
I think this
thus, we had to reconfigure the property. I think we reconfigured it a total of four times in the planning and zoning stages.
We just reconfigured the site, the building site, once.
Well, what he submitted, what Mr. Hassenflew submitted, before we spoke to MSD and MoDOT and St. Louis County, were two different things. So I don't know necessarily that it changed four times. I don't think that's
completely
accurate.
There's already a public right-of-way in the area that we're talking about.
There's a public right-of-way because I believe it's a 50-inch sewer line that runs through that area that MSD says you're not building on. That's part of the problem that we have in that little lot corner that's down there.
I don't think that's a factual statement. That is not a factual statement.
It is in the material that this city presented to this board to look at as to when you gave us all the maps that isolated certain areas that said this is not going to be usable.
I don't disagree with you at all, Andy.
Then you can't tell me that my information's not factual. Okay. I'm using the city's information.
Okay. I didn't say that. I'm in the middle here.
Yes, sir.
So let's just, I think what the information, I agree with you that the information did say that it was not usable, but I think the purpose for which it was not usable was the purpose to which Mr. Hassenflew proposed to put it, which was a parking lot, and it was not usable for that purpose. I do not believe that that excludes the purpose of using it for a pedestrian bridge. And I don't know that to be true. I can't say that that's a factual statement, but I believe it to be true.
And I think what we're here to do is, this is about just starting discussions. So that should all, Alderman Leahy, get all vetted out, went through this process. But the initial calls we've made have indicated, from my discussions with Vola and Lisa, is that the respective public authorities so far have been supportive of a pedestrian bridge being built across there.
It is my opinion that authorizing a tax abatement, the city actually gets very little of the tax money coming off this property.
That's
the
right.
School gets the lion's
That's
share.
Right. That's right.
I don't foresee, I'd like to see the development happen. I did not vote to pass the development. I think there are design problems with it that the neighborhoods may in the time have to address, that there are no options to work with for us. So I am not still in favor of authorizing or even looking to go forward with a tax abatement on this project. And I think it's fair to at least bring that forward at this point before we start investing more resources into it.
Okay.
In the meeting on July 18th, we did the first reading, and at that time it was Alderman Lockmuller who asked the question about the funding. And at that time we were talking about a $22 million development, and we thought that everything was in place. The board approved this project and rezoning on the August 15th meeting in 2016 to work with. But I think where we're headed, I think, is a bad decision for the city of Brentwood and the school district.
Thank you. And just to point out to, for everybody, again, tonight we are not voting on any tax abatement of any kind. Tonight we are simply directing staff to proceed with the negotiation or not. And I think what you're saying, Alderman Leahy, is you would advise not.
I would advise not to proceed.
I just want to make it clear that we're not actually approving a tax abatement this evening. We're simply trying to figure out if we can negotiate one.
And at this point, Mr. Chairman of the meeting, we're not really discussing the resolution. We're just simply asking Mr. Hassenflew questions.
Yeah, at some point, I would hope that somebody on the board would either make a resolution to adopt one of the resolutions that are on the table or to make their own resolution to move forward and give staff direction. That's what we're here to do, is either provide Mr. Hassenflew the certainty that we are in favor of negotiating and moving forward or not, and staff direction to actually go do it.
But later on in the meeting.
Yeah.
Because right now, this is public.
Yes, correct.
Public.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
One other thing, too, I'd like to make clear is, you know, just the spending dollars that'll be brought to this community with this new development. I mean, a lot of these people that don't even live in Brentwood now. This is new base of dollars for people spending here at your grocery stores, at your hardware stores. For my staff, my maintenance staff, to buy hardware, to buy locks, to buy you name it. And there's a tremendous multiplier effect with having residents like this here, and that's why this is very common throughout the area, this type of incentive being done. That's why it was done in Richmond Heights, up there at Brentwood, up there by the the old Draper and Kramer site up there, and other places. It's just
Manhasset Village.
Yeah, thank you, Manhasset Village. There's so many other benefits, and the blight that was there. I mean, it's going to make that intersection really something.
Thank you. there any further questions for Mr. Hasenflew? Any further comments from the board? Mr. Hasenflew, thank you. Would anyone else from the audience care to come forward and address the board? If you do, come forward, state your name, if you would, for the record, and you'll be given 3 minutes. And I think we all know Mrs. Charbonneau, so.
Mr. Horton's making me go first. I was willing to have him go first. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, board. Louise Charbonneau, 8833 Madge. First of all, with regard to Officer Zurheide's retirement, did anybody notice that his equipment belt was still at his waist? He may be snow on the mountaintop, but it looks like he kept himself fit. We may be missing him more than we know. I had a short chat with Mr. Hasenflew before the meeting started, and he did confess that they had come to town really to go to Ferrato's because his wife is from here, and she gets a longing, and perhaps we could all maybe once in a while pack some up in dry ice and send it out to Kansas City. Briefly, my original objections to this redevelopment were based on environment. I considered that area to be a floodplain and that it would be better left as a floodplain. People are more and more clamoring for green space. What a delightful place that would have been for some benches. Maybe the tree bank that I talked about last time where we would plant water-resistant trees, willows or whatever, water-resistant natives that Andy and Sue Leahy could come up with. So that's my initial objection. And then, of course, when he was disavowed of using the whole property by those various government entities and it went to 6 stories, I consider that to be impinging on the privacy rights of the people on top of the hill. Now, other people say, well, they live under a radio tower. Well, they still have already been assaulted by what I consider to be a bad decision with allowing the watering bowl. We know that a woman almost literally lost her mind over that, but that's neither here nor there. And then, of course, as a senior, we get into the traffic implications that Ms. O'Neill brought up with regard to she wouldn't want her children trying to pull out and go east on Manchester Road. The traffic is going to overflow to those northbound streets to the west of the property. Now, with regard to Mr. Hassan just now characterizing the pedestrian footbridge as ancillary benefit, the name of this project is Metro. We have Maplewood and MoDOT fixing the Maplewood side with regard to sidewalk. Remember, I walked it from the Remax building all the way down, and it's going to be gorgeous. So it's just logic that we get the footbridge. But it's not logic to me that the people of our city, who are the city, carry the whole burden of the cost. $445,000, I would like Mr. Hasenflew to have some skin in that game other than just the donation of property. Certainly, he's done some research already. I don't know if you remember, I shared with a couple of you that at the time that he came forward, I had occasion to go to Kansas City. A friend of mine needed a ride. She had to visit her sick sister. I checked out 2 of Mr. Hasenflew's redevelopments. They were lovely. I maybe went looking for a slum ward. I was sorely disappointed. But his practice is to use credits from other places. He did a historic downtown rehab of a factory cold storage building into lofts or multifamily. He's got a low income project out in Bonner Springs, which is the last town before you hit the toll road, so that was a very good thing. And it was a delightful little town. If anybody's a fan of marbles, they got a store with every kind of marble in it. So there's been a lot of hurry up and wait in this project. This has been a long time coming, and always the refrain from our developer, who is a developer, I know, builders must build and developers must develop, that he has to secure his financing, such that he even asked for the rezoning before the site plan was approved, if you recall. So, on balance, the people of Brentwood will be paying. I would just like Mr. Hasenflew to have some skin in the game. It's up to staff to get that with regard to the cost of the footbridge. And I just hope that for once the ball is in our court and I want us to shoot the 3-pointer. I don't want to settle for the 2-pointer. So thank you, and good luck. It's your decision, better thee than me.
Mr. I was about to call on you, Mr. Horton.
You could see I was ready.
I could. And Mrs. Charbonneau gave us a heads up.
Mr. Mayor, members of the board, 6 months ago, almost to the day, I stood right here in front of you all, and I asked about this project. I was the only one who had asked. I did go back and look just to make sure I had asked and seen if anybody else had asked. I asked about TIF, which is, of course, a little bit different, but it has the same effect. We're taking money, as I said 6 months ago, we are taking money from our police, our firefighters, our teachers, and anything else we are spending money on. All right? I can tell you right now, just yesterday, or was it the day before, the governor of Missouri took an axe to the budget.
Yesterday.
Was it yesterday? Thank you. Had to have done it. Doesn't matter if Koster had won, the current governor, Greitens, would have had it been done. It has nothing to do with Democrat or Republican. We don't have money in this state. He took an axe and he swung it hard, and he's going to continue to swing it hard. People that are going to lose out are the folks of this state. Cities get money from the state, just like states get money from the federal government when the federal government cuts. All right? So this is something we need to look for. All right? Some things I want to bring up. Mr. Hassenflew, I apologize. This is not personal. This is just business. All you have to do is get on the internet nowadays and look and see what it is that we have done. Put in my name, put in your name, what business I've done, where I work, where I live, all right? It's especially true of businessmen. It's especially true of businesses as large as Mr. Hassenflew runs. I'm going to give you three examples. The Anderson Alternative School, if you haven't heard of it, it is Independence, Missouri, right? The Garrison Company bought that in 2008 and was going to redevelop it. In 2013, Mr. Hassenflew had been fined multiple times by the City of Independence because that property was falling into disrepair. 5 years he had not done anything. Walked in, bought that property, and did nothing with it. The Majestic Hotel, Hot Springs, Arkansas. People in Hot Springs are very protective of the Majestic. Majestic has been there for a very long time. Mr. Hassenflew walked in and bought that to redevelop it. He had a little bit of bad luck. 2014, a fire broke out. That kind of thing happens. However, in 2015, Mr. Hassenflew had again racked up fines for not doing anything with the property. All right. The final outcome of that, and I wrote that number down, that $834,000, because that is what it's going to cost this city to buy out Mr. Garrison. All right. Hot Springs, Arkansas spent for a $2 million piece of property, they spent outright $680,000 and then allowed Mr. Garrison to write off the other, see if I do my math, $1.2 million as a donation to the city. The city of Hot Springs now owns the Majestic Hotel, which is now being knocked down. All right, we're getting into business with a gentleman who has had some good successes, and he has had some issues. The final one I'll bring up is right here in St. Louis, the Lemp Brewery. It's near and dear to my heart. My wife has recently gotten a job with the Repertory Theater. They have their warehouses down there. I found out this 5 minutes before I walked up here, because that's why I don't have quite as much information. The gentleman who owns it right now is a gentleman, his first name is Sashi. Again, my wife works a little bit with him. All right. He owned it before. He sold it to Mr. Hassenflew, and he now owns it again. Nothing was done. As a matter of fact, the new roof was just put on for $500,000, and that was put on by Sashi, and I think his father owned that. All right. We need to pay attention to the history of our developer. Again, in the minutes, I'm going to write down this date so I can go back and look at it and find out if that $834,000 is spent by this city to buy back that property if this is not developed. All right? Mr. Hassenflut straight up said to us, and I'm going to tell you what, I don't respond very well when I say, hey, let's work together, and somebody tells me, nope, give this to me or I'm not going to do it. I don't respond very well. And a $22 million project, $500,000 over 10 years, I don't buy it. I see I've gone way over my time. I thank you very much. Thank the board, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. John Nuremberger, come on down.
I just would like to say, I was on the P&Z convention when we had this project go forward, and I just want to make sure we know, was there supposed to be a procedure that's followed, like 3333 commission or some TIF commission, to be able to go forward with this before he came to this board to look at doing this? So I just want to make sure we're doing everything that by the city's rules and that sort of thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Karen Smith, I live on Harrison. So when the agenda came forward this request for was in the form of a resolution versus an ordinance, I was a little unclear, and I'm still a little unclear on exactly what is going to be coming forward. Because it was my understanding, when you need tax abatement, you have to have that passed by the municipal governing entity in the form of a law. So I think I understand now that will come. You can't just give tax abatement based on a resolution. But I'm still unclear exactly what we're asking for. And again, I'm sure that's something that would be what the city is going to be working on going forward. But when this petitioner came forward and planning and zoning, I believe it was asked. I know it was asked at the board level. And it was approved at every step of the way based on that there was going to be no ask for public assistance. And now that we've gotten through all these different approval phases, now we're coming forward asking for public assistance. And I do, in some instances, support the use of public assistance if it actually benefits the public. So if, you know, we have to improve an intersection or put in some lighting that's actually on public ground, not on the property itself, I can support that if it is an asset to our community. I believe the current or our incoming governor calls it corporate welfare when we give breaks to businesses when they have plenty of money. Like, I don't believe that we should have provided public assistance to Drury to build their parking garage, which was on their property. I'm trying to understand what's changed between now and when this petitioner first came forward. And anything that's been stated thus far, it's not like he didn't know what the property looked like or you know, that there weren't issues with the blighting, and he was forewarned that there was flooding down there. That's all been out on the table. So I'm just not sure what's changed to warrant why he's coming forward now. And just because others are asking in other municipalities doesn't mean that makes it right. We have several of you on this board ran on the platform of transparency. I think if you all do vote to allow the city to pursue this with this petitioner, that we should make sure that everything is transparent. I thought, based upon how I kind of read the resolution, that we were actually maybe going to get a footbridge out of it. So I'm like, well, that could be public, although I think that it also adds a lot of value to his property, too. So I agree with an earlier comment that he should have something in the provide some funding for that bridge as well. But I think, if I'm understanding the discussion tonight, is we're going to be getting donated back to us a piece of property that many of, like, Corps of Engineers, MSD, has said that it's not buildable, it's in a floodplain. So I'm trying to understand what the city's getting out of this. And then my last comment is in regards to this report that's been done. And this, again, was a report that was done by the developer. I'm just not sure if that is the best way to proceed with that. And I think maybe the city needs to take a closer look at that. I don't think we should trust something that's just coming that the developer paid for to have done. Thank you.
Thank you.
You
got same as everybody.
Member of the Architectural Review Board. I just want to, it's been all well said, I think, to this point, so I'm not going to repeat things that have been said. And, you know, in the interest of, you know, free enterprise, I appreciate the work that wants to be done. I also think, though, that it's going to be a net cost, I think, to the city. I know the development in Richmond Heights technically feeds into our schools, I believe, does it?
That's correct.
So there, right there is a situation where we can't even get any tax money from that development. It's out of our hands, but that's still going to feed into the schools, right? Yes. So we're going to have students. People want to live in Brentwood, right? I mean, I work on the review board. We see houses being built all the time, right? So people want to live here. The schools are good. People know this, and it's way cheaper to live here than Wildwood or somewhere else to get the same school, right? So people are coming in. These apartments will fill up immediately with people who want to get in the school district. So therefore, in my own opinion, it's crazy to not have that paid for by the project itself. I just don't think that's rational, right? So for giving, and someone said earlier that the majority of that money would go to the schools, right? Or in this case, would not go to the schools, right? And so I think that's just bad math. It is corporate welfare, which, you know, with respect to the project, you know, I think it's a good use of the site, actually. I like that it's near the metro. I think all of that is appropriate. But I think he can probably pay for it, you know. And then I would say also, as a single family homeowner, right? Like if the schools sort of sink because there's more people, less money, right? Now my property value starts to go down. I'm not in favor of that whatsoever. To give him a good property value, I don't want mine to suffer, right? It makes no sense to me to vote for that. And then also, I mean, it's with respect, you know, in business you get what you can, right? You know, you do the big ask. And, you know, you might settle for less. So, you know, yes, he's saying 70% is the only way to go forward. I don't believe that for a second, right? Is it 20%? Is it 10%? What is it? Right? That, I want to see that negotiated, and I want to see it negotiated hard. Because I don't want to give my property value away to someone else to get rich. I don't want to do that. I think that's really it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else care to come forward and address the board this evening? Now, don't worry, you get another chance. All right, item number 9 on the agenda. Oh, do we have any aldermanic response? I'm sorry. I apologize.
I have a procedural question, Your
Honor. Yes.
Do we have a response or a resolution to direct the city to go ahead with things?
Is yeah, actually,
on the agenda?
Under item 13, under resolutions, we have two proposed resolutions, and then if anyone would care to make amendments or changes to those as appropriate.
I don't think what I'm hearing is what is in those resolutions.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, I don't think what I'm hearing is in those resolutions. I'm hearing that we need a resolution to ask the staff to proceed. But there are two different, there is not a shall we proceed, there is a shall we do this or shall we do that.
Yeah, that's directing staff to proceed with the negotiation.
All right.
I believe.
Excuse me, I can interject. So the first resolution, I think titled number one,
okay, but you know what? I'm gonna save this whole discussion until we reach that item on the agenda. Okay, folks. So I apologize, but if we start getting off the track and skipping all over the agenda, things are gonna get really crazy really quick. So we're on aldermanic response under item number 8. Alderman Leahy.
The question was asked by, I believe, Mr. Neuenberger and by Carl, the 353 Commission.
Yes.
Is there a procedural step that we may have been overlooking that they should have been involved in looking at potentially doing this, or there's no requirements in the city procedures to go that route now?
My understanding, and I will preface this with my understanding, and I'm sure our city attorney will correct me if I run too far astray, is that the 353 Corporation can be given the power to blight the property but that power has to come from this Board of Aldermen. So it is effectively the 353 that can declare the blight and so on and would negotiate the tax abatement, but that really all of the power to do that comes from this board right
so
here.
So no steps.
We haven't missed any steps because until this board acts, none of that can happen. And really what we're doing is asking for the authority for staff to go and mop up those details in the event that we proceed with them.
Okay. Correct. Yes, Mayor, you're correct, and I cannot emphasize this enough. As always, I am not Kevin O'Keefe. I'm Catherine Henry from his office. Chapter 353 of the Revised Statutes of Missouri sets out a statutory procedure that we must follow if this area is going to be declared blighted. However, what we're determining today is if we can go forward and do the due diligence to determine if that's true. And again, everything from here on out is going to be determined by the board in public after hearings, after notices are given.
Okay. So I know that sounds a little convoluted.
No.
Mr. Mayor, if I could just dovetail on that a little bit with the villas at Brentwood, P&Z at that point knew ahead of time that there was an application coming for the 353, the blighting and the tax abatement request. So they had the opportunity to review it in a different light. In this case, it's kind of happening after that.
Okay. Any further automatic response? Briefly, I'll just touch on the school district. And again, I think it's a very good point because in fact, if we were to do some sort of tax abatement here, the bulk of the money that would be abated would be fees that would pay to the school district. I think it's important to note that at the 70% level that's been proposed, there will be no decrease in income to the school district. In other words, the school district will continue to receive the same amount of money that they're getting from that empty piece of property right now. The difference would be that in 10 years' time, they would then receive the increased value of the property to the school system going forward. And I think that is, in fact, why the school district is, or the school board, the Board of Education, the chairman of the Board of Education, expressed to me a general willingness to proceed along these lines, because they are giving up something. They're committing themselves to getting no more than that for 10 years, but after that, they're committing themselves to getting an increase. They're also, in the case of our particular school district, based on my number of conversations I have with Chairman Ravenberg, they are in fact interested in increasing the enrollment of the school district in Brentwood. And they are not at all concerned about overloading the district at present. So in fact, I think I would go a bit further and say that they're interested in expanding what I would call the economic residential choices in Brentwood so that we can diversify the school community economically. And I think I don't know that this project would do that. I'm not saying that, but I think they're interested in that type of thing. And I think that's part of the reason that they're behind projects of this nature that are residential in nature. So again, I can't speak for the school board, but I have Chairman Ravenberg and I do converse quite a lot. So any further automatic response? All right, number 9, items unfinished business. I don't think we have any this evening. But we don't have any bills for first or second reading or first and second reading, which brings us to item 13, which is resolutions. So,
full circle.
Here we go.
Alderwoman O'Neill, I understand you have a question.
So Resolution 1066 is to authorize the staff to proceed with You describe it.
So the idea is, and I'll even confess that I haven't read them all the way through with my lawyer hat on, but here's what's supposed to happen. One of the resolutions is supposed to authorize staff to move forward with the consideration of the tax abatement or the negotiation of the tax abatement without the necessity of having to include a pedestrian bridge as part of the project. Mm-hmm. The other resolution would ask staff to proceed with the consideration of the tax abatement and include a pedestrian bridge as part of the project. Those are the two resolutions. Of course, if the board is not in favor of doing any of this, then no resolution is necessary. We simply don't take any action, and that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'm completely in favor of authorizing staff to go forward with this. You know, we have to get some information right now, what we're dealing with are just a lot of speculation, a lot of innuendos being thrown around, numbers, the PGAV report, as I pointed out, the tax impact statement on there. We're not really sure what all these numbers mean. The purpose of going forward with one of these two resolutions would be for the city to perform its due diligence and work with Mr. Hassenfluh to come up with with some information and bring it back to us, at which point in time we would then vote whether or not to proceed with this abatement for Mr. Hassenfluh. We're not deciding that tonight.
Correct.
So I'm certainly in favor of getting more information. I like information. What I don't understand, though, is if we want to be more specific, do we need to make an amendment to this? And for instance, if we wanted to, as part of the negotiations, authorize the city to have its own blight study performed, or have the city perform its own tax impact analysis in lieu of going and relying upon what we have in front of us, is that something that would need to be made part of the resolution?
Yeah, I don't think so. I mean, you know, it certainly could be if it's important to you, but I think the very fact that we're having this discussion and the city administrator sitting right here, I think that provides adequate direction in that regard. You know, I think it's like anything else. I mean, you know, we'll tell her to go climb that hill. How she gets there, you know, not really important to us. Well, as long as she gets up to the top.
If that's the procedure that we have followed in the past, I would suggest that we follow that procedure. We continue with that. So to the extent that we have hired an outside body to review the tax impact, I would like us to go ahead and do that again instead of relying upon what we have in front of us. As far as the blighted study, if that's what we've done, I think it's important, obviously, for the city to be selecting the contractor in determining whether or not this area is in fact blighted. I mean, it probably doesn't take the rocket scientist over there on the board to make that determination. He is a rocket scientist.
What do they know about blight? They know about thrusts and vectors.
Somebody
and
I'll
stuff.
Be a lawyer.
I hope not for your sake, Brandon.
I'll be a lawyer.
But, you know, I would like to see us get some more information. And so I think it's important for us that we're selecting the company that performs the blighted study. But what I'm saying is it doesn't take the rocket scientist. I was on planning and zoning from 2006 to 2016, and in that time period, we had two developers come in front of us, not including Truman Bank, which was going to look spectacular back in 2007, and it would have been gorgeous as people came into Brentwood. That died with the economy. After that, we had an auto body repair shop come in front of us. And so for that corner, what we're looking at is having a parking lot, assuming MSD would allow them to construct it, we're now finding out they probably wouldn't, with cars of various states of disrepair. That didn't even get in front of planning and zoning for a final vote. With site plan review subcommittee, the developer realized it was going nowhere. So they walked, and it continued to sit vacant until Mr. Hassenfluh came forward. I think what he has proposed and what this board has already passed, we should not be relitigating the conditional use permit or the rezoning. That has been passed by this board. What is simply in front of this board tonight is whether to authorize staff to perform the due diligence and to report back to us with some information. That's it, as I see it. And I think that we should be doing that. I'm completely in favor of it. It doesn't mean that I'm in favor of an abatement. I'm simply in favor of getting some additional information so that we can then make that informed decision. And finally, as far as I hear people talking about Mr. Hassenfluh failed to tell us, or he was not, I guess, disingenuous, if nothing else, when asked about his request for an abatement or government help in the past. Quite frankly, to me, that doesn't matter because, again, what was in front of us was a conditional use permit and a rezoning request. Nowhere in our ordinances does it authorize planning and zoning or the Board of Aldermen to take that and use that as a consideration in whether to grant a conditional use permit. That's not one of the 11 factors. So it would not have been proper. I think it would have been borderline improper, because if we then made our decision based upon that, we start running into some real problems. And I see our city attorney is nodding in agreement with me. So I just felt it was important to bring that up about this being a new request for an abatement. But having said all that, I'm in favor of it. I just simply want to make sure that we dot all the I's and cross all the T's and do what we've done in the past.
Thank you. Just to be clear to everybody on the board, it is my expectation that if we proceed with one of these resolutions, that the staff would go off and negotiate a redevelopment agreement that they would bring back to this board, more or less ready to go. I mean, we're not simply asking them to come back and give us more information and make a presentation. We're asking them to come back with a proposed deal, and that would be acceptable to Mr. Asenflew and presumably acceptable to staff. And if it were acceptable to the board, then it would get done. So we're really authorizing them to go off, you know, work on our behalf to cut a deal and bring it back to us and see if it's something we like. Alderman Lee.
Okay, Your Honor, when we this board earlier entertained looking at this type of suggestion, and the bridge was suggested over the creek, the other end of the bridge is on property owned by, I think it's Big Bob's flooring, and the other portion of the land that's possible is owned by the advertisement group with the billboard that's down there. It would be nice if you look at option number two. The request is to have the developer have some type of skin in the game. Number two says he's willing to commit some of the land to allow the bridge to be built. But when we last talked about this, the question was the other side of the land even willing to discuss allowing a bridge to be built on their land? So, I mean, yes, I can offer you land that I can't build on. I haven't hurt myself in any way, shape, or form. The fact that I've offered it meets your terms, that I've at least done something. Now it's up to you all to decide if you want to blight and if it's worth $450,000 a tax abatement to proceed. I think we're moving too fast on the resolutions and working through the things, as much as I thought the last meeting we might get more information as to whether the bridge option was feasible. And it sounds like we aren't any further along than we were 3 weeks ago when we had that discussion. So I think, in reality, I'd vote no on both options to work with.
Alderwoman Sims.
Isn't what Alderman Leahy is describing part of the process of negotiating this deal?
I would think so, yes. I mean, if we're going to negotiate a deal to build the bridge, we're going to have to negotiate access to whatever property is necessary to build said bridge.
Okay.
Alderman Lockwood.
Well, my understanding is, Alderman Leahy, that your concerns you have are valid, but if that comes up and this bridge cannot be built, he doesn't get tax abatement.
But you've spent a fortune to get to the decision whether or not you wanted to go that route. The last time we met, the discussion was, is it agreeable to the other party owning the other end of the bridge land? Would they even entertain such an option? If they weren't, then the bridge wasn't going to go anywhere to begin with.
We're not spending anything.
No. The conversation was going to be had as to whether or not the other party that would have the bridge come down on their property, if they would even be receptive to such an idea.
No, that was never.
We're not spending money to do that. Mr. Hassenflew is spending money to do that. No. We're not going to be paying people to study those things. Mr. Hassenflew is. We're simply going to be providing the elbow grease.
Right. So the last meeting was mm-hmm. to provide that information to Mr. Hassenflew that the board would like a pedestrian bridge. And then we contacted MoDOT to talk about the feasibility of doing it and what the cost would be. And of the two sides, where the apartment would be, east or west, it could go either way, but they would prefer to see it where Mr. Hassenflew is proposing. So then it would be his responsibility, and that's part of the discussion, to go approach the other landowners to see whether they would be willing to give some sort of cross access to make it happen. That is part of this redevelopment agreement discussion.
It is my opinion, by getting a quick answer to that question.
There is no such thing as a quick answer.
Well, then we're back to Mr. Dimmitt's request as, is this board entertaining keeping Mr. Hafsenflut's blight study, or are we going to go ahead and spend money to have our own done to work with? Are we going to engage
it would not
Gilmore
be our
Bell
own. It won't be our own money.
Yeah, just to be clear, we're the not developer spending any of our pays own money. If there's another blight study, then Mr. Hassenfield will pay for it. Mm-hmm. On behalf of the city.
On behalf, we're just trying to be sensitive to cost that's already been spent. I've worked with PGAV on other development projects in other cities where I've worked. So if it gives the board comfort, we would sit down with them and go through this to make sure that it's clear. We would have them come to a meeting and present it and answer all your questions. But if the board would like us to hire another firm, the only other firm would be Development Strategies, who did the blight analysis on the Drury Hotel. Stiefel Nicholas would also, I guess, I think they go by Stiefel now,
yes.
Jim Leahy would do the tax impact statement analysis. They would do the financing analysis and indicate whether we think that, you know, the value of that $445,000 is equivalent. They would look at the cost of the pedestrian bridge. We would factor that into it. Should it be 70%? Should it be 100%? That is all part of the discussion of developing the redevelopment agreement, for which Mr. Hassenflut would have to pay for all those consultant costs, including the development agreement itself, where Mark Grimm comes into play.
Thank you.
Alderman Wade.
So, you know, the thing I really liked about the idea that Alderman Lockmiller had about the pedestrian bridge is that, you know, we talk about money, abatement, and this is an opportunity, I think, to have a compromise where you're giving more benefit to the Metro of Manchester. I mean, I personally think that that pedestrian bridge would have tremendous benefit to that, but it would also have tremendous benefit to our town, and that would be something maybe we would, you know, conceivably think about doing, whether Metro on Manchester was going in or not. It's extremely tough to get into that intersection. If you're walking, it's dangerous. You look at what Maplewood is doing on the other side, and it's beautiful. You have, the Sun-In development going on. So, you know, I am very much in favor of trying to find kind of a compromise here that gives benefit to the city as well as helps Metro Manchester be successful. In talking to Alderman Plufka, he also had another suggestion that he asked me to bring in while he's being recognized at the hockey game tonight. But so I got all these good ideas landing around me. You know, someday one's coming here. But, you know, is there an opportunity as well, in conjunction with that pedestrian bridge, to connect to the trails in Oak Tree Park by going along the creek there? And, you know, as we were kind of brainstorming on that, you know, that could fundamentally alter how accessible a lot of things are in that corner of Brentwood. I think that would be something that maybe we could look at as part of this. You know, if we do the option number 2 resolution, that would probably be another donation of land or something. But I would see that as having significant impact, positive impact to Brentwood, because now you can walk to the MetroLink from most of the neighborhoods, which you really can't do easily right now. So that would be one thing I would ask if we are going with option 2. And I guess just a question of, you know, are we looking for a motion here on one way or the other, or?
Yes.
I would move that.
Yes, the chair would entertain a motion.
Then I would
adopt
one of
the two resolutions.
That we adopt.
Or a third one of your own devise.
That I adopt resolution option number 2 with the request to look at potential connection on the.
Did you want to formally amend the resolution,
or
do you just want to make that statement on the record and trust Bola to take care of it?
I trust Bola on this.
All right. Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt resolution number 1066, Metro on Manchester, option 2. Is there any discussion on the resolution? Alderman Crane.
Yes, Your Honor. Bola, when we last visited the topic of, I think it was going to be called the Cleveland Left,
Michigan left.
You know how to remember it, right?
Yes.
Everybody do the Michigan right.
You know where I'm going with this.
Yes.
There was the question of whether or not that intersection was going to be at grade, or whether it was going to be some sort of a bridge the way they have at Manchester and 141. Has there been any further detail given?
No, it is an unfunded project. And from all indications, it will not be funded anytime soon. Soon meaning 20 years or
more. I have a fraternity brother who occupies a position of some authority at the Missouri Department of Transportation, and I asked him that very
question. Okay.
And his response to me was, so, because he didn't want to incriminate himself by saying anything, I took from his response that we should not worry about what MoDOT plans to do with that intersection.
But when I did talk to MoDOT, they were very excited about the idea of a pedestrian bridge.
Yes, as long as we're paying for it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Or somebody else.
The collector.
As long as somebody else is paying.
And they wouldn't onerously withhold some permissions because they want to preserve the right
no.
to.
No.
Okay.
No.
Not at all.
Thank you.
Any further discussion on this? Yes. Alderwoman O'Neill.
All right. The statement here is the agreement shall not authorize real property tax abatement of greater than 70%. Which leads to the fact that it might be less than 70%, but doesn't say specifically that we could negotiate this to another level. Do we need to amend the motion to say that, or is that implicit in this?
Madam City Attorney, do you have an opinion on that?
Your Honor, I apologize. I'm reading the resolution now. Slow reading.
Oh, that's fine.
You know us.
Not at all. I think it's a valid question.
Correct.
It doesn't seem to me to limit the negotiation to...
No, sir, I don't believe it limits it either way. I don't believe the way it is currently written as we're reviewing it is going to hinder us. I don't think we're going to shoot ourselves in the foot, for lack of a better term.
And if it were later interpreted that way, you certainly could go ahead and just ratify the action after the facts.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
If push came to shove, yes.
Just not greater than...
Well, could be, yeah. That's what
she
was asking. Okay. Alderman
Leahy. I'm looking at the memorandum dated January 17th, page 3. Number 3. In the resolution, we're talking about doing a 70% for 10 years. Number 3 says that we also have a 30% abatement for the 10 years, and then a 50% abatement for additional, and then a possible extending for 5. So I guess I'm asking... If you're talking and negotiating a tax abatement, can somebody fully define what the gross terms will be clearly? And
we don't know until we negotiate and run the numbers.
But it's being presented as being
options.
A 10-year.
Options.
Okay.
All these are options.
Just options.
Examples.
Okay, and is there any further discussion? Seeing none, we will have a roll call, please, Mr. City Administrator.
Can you read the motion again?
No, it's been moved and seconded. We're ready to go. Mm-hmm.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
No.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
No.
Alderman Plufka? Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
Yes.
Resolution number 1066, option 2, is hereby adopted by the Board of Aldermen.
All right, very good. We will let staff proceed with that and get an update on that, I'm sure, in a couple, probably a month or two. Item number 14 on the agenda, and I am well past my promise of 1 hour, accounts against the city, Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We only have 4 pages to go through. We'll do this line by line. I have gone over the warrant list in detail with our city administrator, and I would recommend approval of the warrant list in the amount of $183,250.57.
I'll second the motion, Your Honor.
It's been moved and seconded that the board approve the warrant list as submitted. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, we'll have a roll call, please.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Yes.
Alderman Kramer.
Yes.
Alderman Leahy.
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill.
Yes.
Alderman Plufka. Alderwoman Sims.
Yes.
Alderman Wege.
Yes.
All right, motion passes.
All right, the bills are paid for yet another month. Item number 15 on the agenda, reports of committees. 15A is my report. I'm going to keep it really brief, folks. I think there's been a lot of discussion about this, and I think that's great. And actually, I'm of the opinion that anything that gets anybody into this room is a great thing, because this is your chance to participate in your government, and then anything that gets you in here to take part in it is a great thing. I think that what you are seeing is exactly how it should take place, right? People get up, they give their views, the people up here give their views, and at the end of the day, the vote's taken, and we proceed. I don't know how all this is going to work out, but I'm very pleased with how the process has taken place so far, and I commend the board for keeping the discussion on a level that's very productive, I think. So that's my report for this evening. Public Safety Committee, I think Alderman Plufka is out. Public Works, Alderman Leahy.
There is a meeting this Thursday.
There is a meeting on Thursday for Public Safety.
5:30.
5:30 in this room, Public Safety. So, all right, Alderman Leahy.
Public Works meeting is Wednesday night, the 8th of February at 4:30 in this room.
Okay, February 8th at 4:30. I don't see Director.
On vacation.
Okay. Ways and Means, Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We will have a meeting on February 2nd, 6 o'clock.
February 2nd at 6. Mm-hmm. Madam City Attorney, anything?
Just briefly, Mayor, just to follow up with what you said, this is the 353, Chapter 353, is about as public a process as you can get. So whether you're with the project or right, wrong, or indifferent, I think we are looking forward to more meetings like this with hearing from the public, hearing from other departments, retaining consultants. So again, everything is going to be before the city of Brentwood and its residents.
This is just the very beginning of the statutory process.
Yes, sir.
All right, Madam City Administrator.
Nothing, Your Honor.
Assistant to the Excise Commissioner.
Your Honor, the Excise Commissioner and I met kind of a excise committee, if you will, and we have nothing to report.
The exercise.
I'm betting something was exercised at that meeting.
Excise. No exercise.
Madam Library Liaison.
No report.
I have nothing from the Municipal League. Historical Society Chief. Nope. Item 16 on the agenda. Any announcements this evening? Alderman Leahy.
Your Honor, the Ward 3 meeting for the month of January will be January 31st at 7 p.m. and all are invited. And if I may stretch to a personal.
Yes, I was hoping you would. Actually, I was looking up the date for you just
Thank
in case.
You. Thursday, February the 2nd, is a blood drive being held at the Brentwood Rec Center by the American Red Cross for the benefit of Lily La Martina and Christopher Leahy, my son. You can still register by going to redcrossblood.org. And sign up. We're hopefully looking for 140 pints of blood for the purpose of helping the Red Cross restock their blood bank. Thank you.
Thank you. February 2nd, blood drive.
Groundhog Day.
Groundhog Day. Give blood. Get a free donut. It's good stuff.
Thank you.
Yeah. Wow, that was a good one. Any further announcements? New business, do we have any? Sorry, Alderman O'Neill.
Yes, there is a Neighborhood Watch meeting to set Neighborhood Watch for Ward 4 on Wednesday, January 25th at 6:30. If any guests would like to come, that would be lovely. Ward 4's meeting will be at 6 o'clock, January 31st.
Where's your Neighborhood Watch meeting?
Same time as yours.
Where?
25th.
Clubhouse.
At the clubhouse.
Brentwood Forest. Okay.
All right. Any further announcements? Seeing none, new business. Any new business this evening? None? Item number 18 on the agenda, hearing of any matter of public interest upon the request of any person present. If anyone besides Mrs. Charbonneau would care to address the board, come forward and you'll be given 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mayor. I thought of one more point that I thought perhaps one of the board would bring up with regard to the purpose of blighting. And I'm an amateur. I don't have my law degree. But I thought the purpose of blighting was to attract development. And we already have a developer here. So I have a little bit of a problem with having to go the blighting route. I understand apparently that's the only way to go. But with regard to this organization that Ms. Bola has testified as a trustworthy, that we've used them before, if there's a weed that's too tall or a beer can on the ground, do they take a picture of that and call it blight? I prefer to refer to it as floodplain. I think Mr. Dimmitt, did you say it had no other use? It had use as green space. Somebody said it had no other use. And it had use as green space, which does for the soul. And sometimes we have to do for our souls instead of just for our bank books. And as always, thank you. Thank you for your service.
Thank you. Anyone else care to address the board? Going once, going twice. Sold American, any aldermanic response? Seeing none. Item number 19 on the agenda. Folks, we have a closed session scheduled for this evening. Provided that the board votes us into a closed session here in a few minutes, we will adjourn from the closed session. So,
Your Honor,
Scout's honor.
We'll make a motion to go for the board to go into closed session for legal, real estate, and personal L matters, conforming to the Missouri Revised Statute 610.021, subsections 1, 2, and 3.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that the board enter into closed meeting pursuant to 610.21, 1, 2, and 3. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, we'll have a roll call, please.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Plufka? Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
Yep.
Motion passes.
All right, I make it 8:56, folks. We're going to convene at 9 o'clock in the conference room. All right?
Thank you.
That should give everybody a chance to come back.
He does.